现在啊，早上大家好啊，今天的座谈会是以双语进行，就是以英语或是还有中文进行。然后如果你们大家有什么问题的话，你们可以用英语或是华语提出来，我们可以尽量的去解答。
大家好，我是韩永峰。新加坡上市公司，新加坡报业控股集团下属的华文传媒集团下属的联合早报。那我现在就先请我们的这个嘉宾，就坐。不耽误大家的时间，我觉得这个介绍其实也可以很简短。坐在最左边的这位是钱乃基，总裁，他是新加坡华侨银行的总裁。然后他在2007年加入华侨银行，2008年受委为华侨银行的环球总裁，也就是说负责华侨银行的所有业务。然后呢，后来呢，现在就变成整个华侨银行的总裁了。他也是新加坡银行工会的主席。这个钱先生有31年的银行业经验，他是科班出身，毕业自美国加州大学洛杉矶分校。这个是一个简单的介绍。然后钱先生旁边的是我们的吴总。吴总他是，对不起，我还是这个很认真的看一下。沈恒先生，他是中远集团中远投资有限公司副董事长兼总裁及执行。那么呢，吴总毕业于大连海事大学，然后他跟所有的中远的领导一样，以前我都了解，他们都是从基层做起的，开始都是从水手一副、二副、三副做到现在。他从1982年加入中远，然后有丰富的经验。他是在2011年的时候来到新加坡。然后这个那些我就不介绍了。我们现在先开始这个专题讨论啊。可能我第一个问题我先问一下钱总跟吴总吧，让这个年轻人休息一下。My first question here is about this dealing with disruption and thriving in China's new normal. 所以新常态有颠覆，然后中国刚刚公布了第上半年的经济增长是7%。So the first half of the year GDP growth in China is 7%. And IMF has predicted the GDP growth will slower down further to 6.8%this year and 6.3% next year. 就 IMF 预期中国的经济会继续放缓。可能今年是6.8%，明年是6.3%。So, 这个 Mr. Chen and 这个吴总，你们觉得中国的经济的增速的减缓是一个我们值得担心的现象吗？ Is it something that we should worry about? 然后你们如何看待你们两位的公司未来12个月的收入增长前景？ Do you think the prospects for growth for a company?In the next 12 months, shall we
like
Mr. Chen? Okay,
用英语说。因为我普通话讲得不好，所以用英文讲啊。We have to look at the Chinese economy in a different way than the Western economies have been looking at the Chinese economy. Of course, we all know that the Chinese economy is being centrally planned. But it is not easy to have a centrally planned economy.Had you not have the following three things, which only China has. China has the channel, China has the tool, and China has the information. There is no big economies in the world that has got all these things concurrently available to the government at the same time. China has the channel because China has the state-owned banks. China has got other measures that they can channel through.The financial system to control the economy or to expand the economy. China also has the tool. The tool could be a monetary policy tool, but the tool could also be a raw data tool, such as giving loan quotas to the banks for them to extend financing or to contract financing. China also has the information. China knows exactly what is happening.In any part of the sectors. If you look at the bank, for example, we have to submit reports to PwC, to CBRC, and to save, not only on the daily basis. Altogether, we have to submit about 700 reports every year to these three agencies. So they have all of the information available. So in that context, the Chinese economy is actually a managed economy, and it is the right thing to do because the Chinese economy is at the state where the private sector's driving of the economy may create volatilities of which the country is not ready to accept, which may result in social implications which could be beyond what the government is ready to accept at this present time. So with this background, when we look at the Chinese economy growth slowing down from 14.2%, which is the peak in 2007, to last year's 7.4%, Western economists are very concerned because this is the lowest economic growth over the past over 10 years. But then if you look at another figure, which is a more important figure to the Chinese Central Planning Party, and that is the creation of employment. In 2007, the Chinese economy created 11 to 12 million new jobs. Last year, when the economic growth came down to 14.2, the new job that came down to 7.4, the new job creation was 13.2 million. It is even higher than in 2007 when the economic growth almost doubled that of last year. And this is what the Chinese government has been focusing on as the real indicator of the healthy growth of the economy. So from our perspective, we think the Chinese economy is transforming, and along the transformation there will be some casualties, but directionally it is doing exactly the right thing. The question is, at what point in time would the job creation be so low that it will cause social unrest? We do not know exactly what that figure is, but according to my interactions with the government officials and with the finance department, we think if the job creation falls to 10 million or below, there will be some social implications. So they will do everything possible to make sure that the employment new job creation is around that level. Once it drops to below that level, I think there will be an issue. Because you have to take care of the 6 to 8 million university graduates every year. You have to take care of urbanization of the people coming into the new cities. So job creation is actually the more important thing. So when we look at, coming to your most question, I am not concerned at what has been announced in terms of GDP growth. Because behind the GDP growth, there is a more important indicator, and that is job creation. And job creation continues to be healthy at 13.2 million last year.
世界其他经济体是不一样的，中国还算是一个计划经济，然后呢，中国的政府拥有其他的大型经济体，拥有的一些条件，三大条件，一个是渠道，一个是供需，一个是资讯，就是渠道它有国有银行，工具是它有很多政策的工具，包括它可以控制那个放贷率，然后还有中国的政府掌握很准确的信息。 因为每个领域其实都掌握，我觉得就差不多一张，所以呢，这个中国政府其实都很了如指掌。然后除了在经济增长以外，更令人关更值得关心的是就业率。而中国的就业率，像在去年是有1320万的就业率，比中国经济增长最好的时候的就业率还要高。 所以从新增的就业机会，所以呢，从这个角度来看，经济放缓不令人担心，而且中国在做的是对的、正确的事情。唯一要担心的就是，当新增就业机会下降到1000万的时候，可能就会有一些社会风险。那么呢，钱总认为中国政府会尽一切的努力，去使这个新增就业机会尽量保持在1000万左右。 在1000万以下的时候，可能才有一点需要担心，大概是这个意思吧。
谢谢。
那我们请那个吴总谈一下。
其实想要说的话都让我们那个 Frank Dean 嘛都已经说完了、所以说我接着说，他说的非常好，说到我的心坎里去了，我非常赞同他。那么要说这个问题吧，我接着说这个问题又太大，这是属于说经济学的理论。所以说我们那个谭德成呢在请我来的时候，我就说我不是经济学家，我只是一个市场上的一个弄潮儿，我来谈好像有点班门弄斧，也说不到位置上。那么好在我们 Frank Lim 啊讲得这么好，所以说我根据他说的哈，我来回答这个问题啊，用新常态下的几个机遇啊，看能不能把这些问题啊让我们树立起一个信心来。因为无论这个问卷是怎么问的，我感觉说信心的下滑就在于说我们对市场对形势的判断还是有些问题。因此啊，我就感觉说在刚才所介绍的新常态下有那么几个我们应该可以进行的想一想看对不对。也就是大国效应已经出来了，中国的大国效应出来了，这里面体现出两个，一个是大市场，因为中国原来是属于说世界工厂，但是它已经把世界工厂现在逐步的演变成为一个世界的市场。中国的需求带来向全球的采购，去年增长13%，因此在这一块啊，它就带动了中国经济，不仅仅是带动中国经济发展，更重要的是使得世界经济的一个稳定器，这个中国的经济其实是产生了一个非常重要的一个作用。当然在这个过程中我们还看到这个大国效应中还有一个就是大消费，既有中国的需要，中国的采购，也有中国由过去的商品输出变成了现在的一个资本性的输出，就是刚才介绍的一路一带。因此我觉得说在这个问题上我们可以看到这个大国效应可以通过大市场和大消费有一个很大的一个体现出来。第二个就是要还要看到一个机遇，就在于说中国在多极化的进行一个增长。大家都知道中国太大了，边界多少个国家，应该是20几个国家，是世界上没有这么多，有一个这么多。但是中国也正因为说有东西中部这么经济发展的一个不平衡，中国刚才已经介绍了10万亿美元的 GDP， 人均大概是8000，但是到了东北地区或者是西部，穷的可能只有2000多，所以这市场非常大，所以中国在发展的这个厚度和宽度特别大，东部产能过剩的可以逐步的向西转移，在转移的过程中西部得以发展。所以我觉得说这是一个非常重要的一个因素。因为我们如果是画一个图下来，我们可以发现在西部地区经济的不够活跃，经济的总盘子总量都不过，但是到了东部还是比较大的。这个转移过去以后啊，那么就会带来一个新的经济的发展，经济的腾飞，这是第二个方面我们应该看的，这是一个有非常大的一个大众生。第三个方面我们要谈一个人口红利问题。在第一次的人口红利主要是用农民工，那是一个低端的劳动力。我们现在看中国的新闻，一个是民工荒，就业难是关键的词，但实际上还有一个关键的词，那就是大学生就业难。那么还有农民工难找，这也是两个关键词。这两个关键词带来是什么呢？每一年中国新增的大学生有700万，这是一个很大的数字，相当于说新加坡将要发展的690万的这么一个人口，但是年增的大学生就是700万，他们就业很难。这个时候带来一个什么新的现象？这几年的数字，新增的大学生起薪的工资已经跟农民工的基本工资基本拉平。那么带来的是什么呢？ 劳动力的素质在提高，人力资源本来这是人力资源的大国，已经不断的迈向人力资源的一个强国，这是一个可喜的。那么这就讲了说叫大人才，还有一个数字，就是第四个数字，我们也要注意看一看技术红利，因为我们今天专门特地讨论一个技术变革问题。技术变革最重要的是技术吗？不是，我的感觉是变革的思维，只有说你有变革的思维才可以运用这个技术，技术永远是个工具，但是这个思维高于你的工具。你有一个好的产品不会运用，刚才说的很多的数字，你若是拿到手上没有个灵敏度，那是不行的。不知道给我多少时间了、讲一个题外话让大家听一听笑一笑。我们都知道林彪从他打仗开始，每一天有个小本子记录报告，报告什么，在辽沈战役的时候为什么这么快就打胜了。他这天刻着豆在听一个报告，说是有一支部队消灭了多少人，有多少长枪多少短枪，报告。他马上就叫住，停住，为什么这一次的报告是短枪多长枪少，重型武器少，马上派部队把这支部队狠狠地跟踪消灭他，那就是廖耀湘司令部一下子被端掉了。所以说就像，所以说数字的拿到数字这个敏感度是取胜的一个非常重要的一个因素。那么我们现在讲的这个技术红利啊，我就谈到一个，这是一个大创新的概念。我们应该看到这几年呢，中国的在申请专利上有一个很大的上升，去年应该是突破了260万件，在全球，在全球从2013年开始，在全球的技术创新的这个申报中啊，占了31%，就前年已经占了31%，是成为世界的第一个。第二个，我们还看到了是 R&D 的一个投入。过去中国无论企业或者是国家对 R&D 的投入是少之又少，去年已经达到了整个 GDP 的2.09%，这是一个很大的一个大创新的一个很重要的一个投入。第三个数字就是技术市场的活跃度啊，在不断的提升，这个就仅仅在去年就增长了16%。还有一个数字呢，就是高新技术的这个产品的出口大幅的增加，就比如说在去年整个出口的贸易量30%是属于高技术的产品，这就是一个向好的一个信息。还有最重要的一个，就是中国是拥有世界上最大一支科学研究队伍，这个量是最大的，因此后生的动力确确实实是很强。因此谈的技术变革技术创新不缺人才，人才有的是，但是人才不仅仅是数量上是第一，质量上有待于提高，更重要的是为这个人才的发展应该是在管制上更加的放开。刚才我们有谈了很多的希望的是政府能够提供更多的人才。刚才也讲到了很多的人才的问题，人才多了但是他们的吃苦精神不够了，是吧？因为大学生一下让他做基础工作不一样了。还有一个，人才多了让他们怎么样在同样的一个竞争市场上他们能够充分的发挥他们的潜力，他们能够得到公平的待遇，公平的发展，这就是政府这样解决的问题。还有一个第五个方面的一个数字啊，我接着说，要看一个升级版的中国。这个升级版的中国很大，现在中国已经产生了很多新的概念，在大数据、互联网加，还有中国装备2025，还有哪一个自贸区，从北到南，从东到西，都有很多这些自贸区。上海自贸区、天津自贸区、广东自贸区、福建自贸区，每一个自贸区都有它各自的重要的这个内容，而且是不同的主攻的方向。当然还有小的自贸区，比如说舟山自贸区、 重庆自贸区等等，这些自贸区也是对我们整个中国经济的一个生成板呢，是非常重要的。那么还有一个很重要的，在这个升级板中，我们还看到一个消费。过去的中国老百姓在三十年的过程中，主要是以吃住行为主的消费，现在已经从高端的制成品的或者是服务型产品的消费已经转移过去了，所以说这就是一个大升级。最后一个，我们还要看一个经济全球一个大布局，那就是大开放，就是刚才我们所介绍的一路一带的建设。这个不久前我也参加一个活动，有人提问我一个问题，中国现在进行了反腐，是不是整个速度想下来，是不是主要的原因？官员们不作为，老百姓不干活，是不是一个很重要的原因？我就讲了一路一带的问题。一路一带，一路是在2013年五月份，习主席出访的时候提出来的。建设21世纪海上丝绸之路，是习主席在印尼国会上发表演讲的，也就是2013年的十月份第一次讲出来的。AIIB 就是亚洲基础设施投资银行的概念，也是在这个会议上提出来的。我问当时在座的人，我说在座的人当时听完以后有什么感觉吗？他们回答不出这个问题。当他们没什么感觉的时候吧，已经纷纷出台了。57个国家进入到亚洲设施投资银行进来了，一路一带的建设方兴未艾。所以我就说这能够说是速度慢吗？有很多国家都没反应过来，但是已经在积极推了。所以我是感觉说这一次的这个整个的这个调研呢，我也是参与这个调研的这么一个过程，我也收到这个问卷。当前最可怕的就是信心不够。有我刚才所介绍的这几个要素，更有我们刚才 Frank Lim 和我们 OCBC 的这个总裁所介绍的这个情况，我感觉说我们不应该丧失我们的信心。可能我是一个乐天派，回答的不一定对头。谢谢。
都要有信心，要有正能量。这个经济下滑，不是还是转成正式黄金甲。我们下来一个问题就是，请问一下，但是从大的环境是这样，但是对企业来说，这意味着什么呢？中国现在在经济在调整，在平衡，进入新常态，这个整个变化对企业来说是不是一个威胁？然后除了这些威胁，我们在中国经营企业是不是还有其他的威胁？The question is, seems that there's still pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, but then the whole process of restructuring and rebalancing, does that pose a threat to companies operating in China? So is this a threat, and what are the other threats and risks that companies operating in China may have to face? You would like the three panelists to give us an answer? 我们可以先请这个钱先生，然后吴先生，然后最后林先生给我们做一个讲解，谢谢。
To your question, I think we have to understand the Chinese economy. We have to understand that it is transforming. And once we understood it is transforming, you take a look at a slightly longer term, and you know that these things are actually good for the economy in the long run. During the interim, there could be some exposures that you do not like to see. The question then is how to avoid those exposures. From our perspective,The largest risk in China during this period of time is policy risk, because the government may announce certain policies which is good for the country in the long term, but in the interim there could be some disruptions. Take an example. We all know that the SOEs, in China we talk about SOEs, but we are concentrating on the 112 SOEs, which is directly under SASAC. The SOEs will be reformed. Now, we don't know what the reform is, and we don't know whether there will be casualties. So the way to look at it is that we should not avoid the SOEs, but we should focus on those SOEs which is of national interest to the country, and we should also focus on those SOEs where the reason for its creation is still there. So you've got Costco, you've got COFCO, you've got Sinopec, but you also have many other metal mineral SOEs. Some of these companies have expanded into areas which was not their core business. In those cases, we have to be careful that our involvement is more on their core business rather than their less core business, because it is possible that while these SOEs are being reformed, those non-core businesses could either be shut down or be moved to another entity, in which case there could be some exposures to us. So for OCBC, for example, the most important thing to me is to understand what is happening, why it is happening, and despite the fact that the country is transforming, there are still lots of opportunities for us to embark on, for us to pursue. The market share of the foreign banks in China is only about 2%. OCBC's share is to about 2% of that 2%. So it's very, very small. It's very, very small. So there is enough opportunities for us to pursue, but you have to pursue the right areas. How do you find the right areas? Is you really need to understand what is happening in that economy, and then you try to avoid those areas which could be hit by the policy risks. So we continue to be positive that there will be a country of which the whole banking industry should continue to pursue. But you cannot just pursue it based on your superficial analysis. You have to understand deeper as to what it is. I faced a lot of questions is China going through a hard landing or a soft landing? So I think generally people will say it's a soft landing, but to me it is not. To me it is neither soft landing nor a hard landing. It is a long landing. Long landing means that it is a managed landing in such a way that will not cause the bumpiness along the road, but it will land. Now, it doesn't mean that it will land at 1, 2%. I think China's economy will probably still be able to grow at about 5 to 6% level, which continues to be healthy. As I said before, the most important thing is to make sure there is job creation. The Chinese government is doing a lot to do job creation because the economy has already moved. I don't know whether you know, the service component of the Chinese economy is now 51.4%. You see, Chinese economy started as agriculture, moving to manufacturing, which is industrial, now moving into service. Service economy component is now 51.4%. The good thing about service economy is that you can create a lot more activities than if you were in the industrial economy or in the agricultural economy. Urbanization is another thing that the Chinese government has embarked upon. There is 100 cities identified as the future urbanized cities. And once you have an urbanized city, plus service-oriented, you create domestic consumption. Once you create domestic consumption, the economic activities will rise such that there will be job creations that you otherwise would not be able to create had it been in an agricultural economy. So that's how we look at it. So I think companies, banks, should continue to have that confidence, as Wu Zhong has said, so that we'll be able to understand and pursue and help the country grow and help our businesses grow.
我们应该是用那个SWOT来进行分析，这才比较好。意思要通过我们企业的内部的资源以及外部的环境，还有我们有哪一些机遇、威胁，这几个方面进行综合的考虑，然后根据我企业的战略来考虑我的一些布局。我就说应该是这么一个是比较好的一个方向，因为如果是光讲威胁，那么我们肯定是灰心丧气，直接的说不行下滑，确确实实是在下滑。因为你整个GDP、整个总量下来，那么企业的收入肯定是不高。但是我们有一些数字，我们还可以进行分析。我们现在写7%，刚刚才公布的上半年7%，我个人的分析高于7%，怎么来的？ 刚才我们Frank Dean介绍的，中国的经济的三大板块，央企就是国有企业、外商企业、民营企业，大家所知道的原因，民营企业报出来数字只有低没有高，外商投资企业报出来数字也是 只有低没有高，真正的一个准确度的还是这个样期。所以说你说7%是假数吗？应该是高于它。还有一个数字没有纳入到 GDP 的这个里边去算，就是中国老百姓家庭盖房子的这个没有算到里边。但是现在中国盖房子，你们开着车到中国哪一个城市去逛，私人盖房子多少，这也没有算到 GDP 里边。所以说我感觉说 GDP 这个数字啊，应该是高于7%，不会低于7%。讲这个威胁的这个事啊，我就感觉说我是在海上漂了很多年了哈。所以说我们的航海的一句术语叫做时刻把自己放在最危险的位置上，这是对的。那么也就是说我要时刻考虑我的威胁，但是你在考虑你的威胁的同时，你还要更重要的是瞄准你商业你企业发展的机会。我们讲的西楚霸王怎么说，他如何定定他的位置呢？那就有一个破釜沉舟。他就是正因为有了破釜沉舟，大胜的优于自己的对手，才奠定了他西楚霸王的这么一个地位。他是拍脑袋的吗？不是。他仅看到他的威胁吗？他早就看到了，但是他相信他自己的士兵自己的队伍优于他的敌手。所以啊，现在我们在看到威胁的同时啊，我们应该是在这个低迷的这种情况下把自己的事情做好，壮大自己，机会是大大的。
吴总是现代的郑和。
啊，我是感觉说最大的威胁啊，我现在感觉说我们现在无论哪个企业或者是我们在座的每位啊，最大的威胁是我们自己，就是我们自己只要是信心不足了，全都垮了。
没有什么特别补充，我觉得有机会就有威胁，是最大的威胁。坦白讲呢，就是说你一看到有机会，你不去抓住这些机会。其实中国现在真的是竞争当然是越来越厉害，但是实际上机会多的是。我们自己在中国不是很长时间保养到，但是实际上我们看到的就是也是这样子，我们这个行业竞争越来越厉害，但实际上机会呢也是越来越多。当然价格也是很大的压力，成本架构也是非常非常的压力。我们的工资涨得比你们的工资还高，但是实际上的话呢，我们为什么还是拼命的在招人，就是要还是看到很多很多的机会。而且不只是我们中国保养到中国，是保养到在中国看到的，我们全球的人每一次去谈的时候的温金制造这个事，谈来谈去都是说中国还是有很大的机会。所以当然是有很多问题要解决，但是实际上这些问题的话呢，我刚刚讲的那两个问题对其实中央的一些这些搞政策人也有一点不公平。我讲的那两个，我再试试搞这个问题啊，咱们要公平一点。那我们就说你们有没有好建议给这些中央政策人说，哎，应该怎么样去做呢？如果有了，大家去跟他们讲，他们没有推出来了，那这个我觉得就是问题是这些问题呢都是一个很复杂的一个问题。中国的这些深化改革为什么没有股权激励啊，这个也是牵涉到有一些国有资产的这个怎么样去平衡的话呢，你怎么是有激励，怎么叫做国有资产流失，这个是也是一个很大的一个问题。所以我们讲来讲去的话呢，都是要看的这个问题呢是有在的，但是要慢慢的怎么样去解决。而且中国的这个市场或者政府来讲的话，还是要很稳健很平衡的去处理问题的，因为人口太多，太大的一个地方，有很多复杂的事情。
我们要先让可能有人迫不及待要提问了，而且我们的时间也不够，那我们现在就开放给在座的各位争取这个机会跟他们提问。这位先生好像已经
刚刚郭CDC全总说了，中国面对的问题就是制造就业机会。我觉得论点很正确，你由宏观的角度来看，就业机会的制造在未来几年里面能够完成。
未来两三年到五年，我觉得这个不是一个大问题。 因为毕竟政府还是会创造很多的这个机会，而且在推动方面的话呢，但是到了某个程度的话呢，我个人，这个是我个人的观点啊，你做什么东西呢，你将一个转型，由一个制造业转型到一个比较有质量的服务行业，高质量行业，慢慢的呢就会讲效益。到了讲效益的时候的话呢，其实你就会面临到呢，其实西方国家的经济的一些问题，这个就是 unemployment 就会增加，这个呢就到时候呢就是一个很大的问题，因为工资提高了嘛，你工资提高的话呢就要讲效益，一讲效益的话呢就是开始就是说本来是十个人做的，就我们也面临这个，本来是十个人做的事情，现在是五个人就可以做完了，然后你的业务量增加了，你这个五个人十个人还是可以做这个 double 的东西，但是到了你再增加上去的时候，你请的人就会越来越少。这个确实坦白讲啊，我不是一个经济学家，但是我觉得长远的话，你看十年二十年的话呢，这个确实是一个问题，而且技术的含金量越高的话呢，你需要用的这个人力资源就会越来越少。就好像我们以前用秘书，现在秘书用的这个用途跟以前不一样的，而且秘书可以越用越少，其实是很多事情你都可以自己做的，这个就是一个长远的，不只是中国，这个其实在美国啊，在英国啊，在德国都面临这个问题。
If I may just supplement what Frank has said in response to your point, the most important thing is to promote the private sector.
Yeah.
Because the private sector can create enterprises, SMEs,to create additional employment. You cannot just rely on the public sector. And what the government has been doing is to encourage some funding to go to the SME sector, which is not successful. And that's why we still have the shadow banking area, which is difficult to control. So what the Chinese government is trying to do is to give incentives to the banks to lend to the SMEs, and also to promote the people to be entrepreneurs. So now there's this slogan, 它叫什么？它叫大众创业，万众创新。
对，
万众。万众创业是 everybody should try to be an entrepreneur, and then everybody should be innovative and creative. This slogan has a lot of intelligence behind it, because the ultimate purpose is to create a larger private sector in order for them to do. This stock crash actually is all lumped together.The stock market boom is orchestrated by the government, but they lost control along the way because they have not expected that the leverage could be so high that there will be so much money channeled back into the stock market. But if you look at it, the Chinese government is willing to pilot. Would our government be willing to pilot? If you do not pilot, how can you learn?I'm pretty sure that next time when there's a stock market boom, the situation will be entirely different because they know what areas to look for. This time, they overlooked the power of the leverage. As Frank had said, the over here, if we advance against shares, if it's a blue chip shares, we may advance you 40%. In China, they advance you 80 to 85%. So for every $1, as Frank said, they lend you $4 more, so you've got $5 to invest into that stock.They missed that. So they're now controlling it by making sure that it's got a long landing instead of a sharp drop. This is very different from the US. When US economy have a problem, they do a thorough restructuring. They do more than is necessary so that you have a new start. In China, they don't do that. They have a long landing such that the structural problems will continue to be there. It will take a longer time to resolve. But during the meantime, there is less pain, less casualty, less social unrest.
Sam, I have a question for you. I like the word you described. It's long landing, like what the Chinese say, long march. I understand, Chinese government is going to liberalize the interest rate. How do you see that impact on the banking sector? And also, when you talk about, encourage, stimulate the private sector growth, the last few years, the result didn't seem to be that ideal, right?I had opportunity to visit Wenzhou 2 years ago. That's supposed to be the home of the private enterprise.
Wenzhou is an extreme place. Like, it's an extreme place where people are extremely aggressive. I don't think Wenzhou is representative of the entire China.
I agree.
Yes.
You have a good presence in Ningbo. You are one of the big shareholders of Ningbo. And Zhejiang people, by nature, they are very adventurous. I understand from Ministry of Finance a number of years ago, Zhejiang, although it's a small province, but their revenue contribution to Chinese Ministry of Finance is way out. It's a lot more than even Guangdong at one point. And how do you see OCBC play the role? I understand your bank is the first Singapore bank to set up a private investment fund in a Shanghai free trade zone, 普通自由贸易区. And I believe that one had worked quite well. It was quite a bit of publicity last year. And I think OCBC ahead of the other two major competitors. Congratulations to you on that.
Thank you, thank you. I would not expand on this last point. but I want to address one point, which is my own observation. We talk about certain people are more aggressive. For example, Wenzhou or Zhejiang, as you've mentioned. I look at it differently. I think that people have got more confidence that should there be a problem, they will be able to overcome that problem along the way. So I think this is the mentality that some provincial people have more than the other provincial people. And I think we should have that as well. It is very difficult when you approach the China market to have the entire business plan mapped out, end-to-end process already established. Because the market is so changing so fast, evolving so fast. We should have the confidence in ourselves when we develop the business that you move in and you run into certain issues, you refine the business model along the way, and you continue to move ahead. If you wanted to adopt a very academic way of approaching China and say, I want to know what the end result is, and then this is the process, you map up the whole process. By the time the process mapping is completed, the market would have evolved already. So it is very important when you approach the China market, you move in, understand, refine, re-refine along the way, and that's the only way to understand the market. I think when you talk about the OCBC approach, we are also doing that. You know, we make some investments into a bank called Bank of Ningbo. We gradually increase the investments. It's now at 20%. Along the way, we try to assess whether those are the people that we would like to work with. Are they open sharing? And what are the business model? And then we gradually increase. So that's the way to do the business in China. You cannot jump in there and basically said, according to my analysis from offshore, this is the right thing to do. Because once you're inside there, you know that it's a different story. So better start there, but not to go there is also not right. You know, in our customer base, I can safely say that 90% of my SMB customers, you know, OCBC is pretty big SMB, 90% of my SMB customers have got a presence in China. But it doesn't mean it's a big presence. It could be just a cousin who is there as their representative. It could be a sales rep over there. But 90% of the SMEs in Singapore already has somebody with them. This is the right thing to do. You need to have somebody over there to understand what is really happening to help you to promote the business. You cannot adopt a very academic approach to China.
You're the oldest bank in Singapore, and you have presence in Xiamen long ago. And Linpo, I've been there a few times. I was involved in cinemas. And I know Linpo people are very enterprising. In fact, they produce world-class businessmen. Yeah, just to name a few. And you mentioned about the Chinese really had to push for private sector. The impression I got the last few years was that, you know, the big four or big five, they are quite reluctant to lend to private sector. They rather prefer to lend to a state-owned enterprise, yes, because it's safer.
Correct.
They traditionally had that mentality. And private business, there are some good ones. I'm not talking about Wenzhou. I'm talking about some good ones. But there is a complaint I heard about. Private sector find bank financing very difficult.
Very true.
And government trying to push for, but I didn't see any breakthrough. And how OCBC look at it? You as an overseas bank, obviously you are very strong in SME. You are the safest bank in the world. One of the top. And how you see the credit risk? Don't you think the big five are too cautious, too defensive when it comes to the area where they should do some financing, but they hold back? They are overly concerned about credit risk.
Can we connect a few questions together, and then we let the panelists discuss together?
Thank you.
但是我倒是有一个问题啊，就是我们原来这个报告的主题也是讲到要创新嘛，然后在调查问卷里面有显示说跟国际同行相比，中国的 CEO 啊对于数字化技术，对于从数字化技术创新中创造价值，他们比较没有信心。您这个我们可以问一下，可能林先生，你觉得这个数字化技术可以怎么样帮助企业建立他们的竞争优势？而且这个企业要学会用数字啊，他要突破哪一些主要的障碍？
我就用一个，我就不讲名字，我们有一个客户，中国其中一个最大的保险公司，他们正在 push 这个东西 ，push 的非常好，所以我有一点 surprise， 就是，但是你要看这个 survey 是哪一种企业。我前一阵子一个多月前，我们还跟那个董事长吃过一顿饭，那一天刚刚他是他们创立了才25周年，现在市值是差不多1500亿美金的市值，那我就不讲名字。他们现在的战略是思维是很清晰的，他那天跟我们再分享一下的战略思维，其实就是第一个就是要大数据，这个数据的分析，第二就是四样东西，他讲的是衣食住行，食我忘记了，衣不是这个衣服，是医疗，住行都用这个大数据，他是做保险的。他现在有在做经营其他的金融板块，而且这个非传统金融，他们的这个战略思维就是，而且呢，他们投入了很多的力量，用了很多的咨询公司帮他们去做这个东西。这个呢，我觉得呢，他们这个战略的思维呢，其实老实讲的话呢，如果中国有多几家这样的公司，真的是不得了。而且他 target 其实不是海外市场，中国的市场，是中国的市场。但现在的这个战略思维呢，现在看起来就是说它只是在囤积，在成本方面它会多一点，但是实际上在这些大数据的分析它拿到了以后呢，它可以呢在这四个板块之下的话呢，再创造一些呢现在没有的，或者是传统行业的，譬如说在金融板块方面，他们有进入这个 internet 这个金融板块这块东西了，那这样子他们也有传统银行，但是这样子的这个一个思维的话，你就可以看得到的话，其实呢，中国还是有很多的这个企业家，而且这个不是国家拥有，国家有一些股份，但是私人拥有基本上，这种企业的话呢，是完全全全就是呢在掌握，而且他也 ready 跟我讲说，未来的几年中国经济是会比较艰苦的，但是实际上的话呢，他们还是看到机会是非常非常的多，所以我觉得大数据呢。刚刚讲的是你要怎么样去就是利用这个东西，然后看你 focus 在哪一个 area， 拿到这些数据以后你怎么样去将这个数据用在你的这个现有业务上还有新的业务上，这个是非常非常关键。
请
你们
First of all, I would like to endorse what Frank had said. I think your survey results is a surprise to me.
No, our survey is not.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes,
yes. I know. Surprise to you.
It's a surprise. I suspect that maybe the customer base is more foreign companies in China, of which the digitalization is happening in their parent office outside of China. So I'm quite surprised, because if I look at it, the digitalization in China is quite advanced. Yeah. Coming back to the SME lending, currently the state banks are still concentrating on the SOEs, as you described, because it is easier to do business, they know who the people are, and it's big ticket items. So there is no incentive. In the previous days, there was a loan quota that was given to each. So the chairman of the bank's first job at the beginning of the year is to negotiate with CBRC chairman as to what is the loan quota they allowed for that year. And at that time, it was a restrictive loan quota, so you cannot be exceeding that amount. So if you have this loan quota, you tend to extend these loan quotas to the larger companies, so it's easier to do business. Now, because there's no more loan quota, not that because they don't need it, but actually it's the other direction. They want to promote lending. I think the SMEs will be able to benefit. Now again, if you look at China, in the event that the SMEs is not getting enough lending, what I think, as I said, Chinese government has the tool, has the knowledge, has the channel, they're going to say not less than 20% of your lending must go to SMEs. You see, that's the way to do it. And it's possible that they can do it by policy to do it. So right now, you're quite right. But over time, as the government policy is 万众创业, 大众创新, 情况之下, there would be complementary policies introduced to channel money there. And they will try to see whether the shadow banking can be managed in such a way that it will be channeling money to that sector in a more regulated manner.
If I may also supplement, I think actually the big banks, in particular, I think one or two of them have already started lending to small, medium enterprise. The difficulty actually, once they lend to the small, medium enterprises, because the stock market actually, they then funnel the money to obviously stock market speculation for whatever reason. That obviously something is obviously is the sort of unintended consequences because of the sort of the stock market boom set. And secondly, like companies like or banks like I would say the China Merchants Bank, they've actually been lending to SMEs quite prevalently. And I think for the SMEs in China, if you actually look at China, it's not just the bank lending actually. It actually the private equities, the venture capitalists in China and overseas have been doing a lot of investments in some of the very very good small medium sized enterprises. And I think the stock market obviously. Boom encouragement by the government was also one of the intention was to see how they can actually help the small medium sized enterprises to actually progress even quicker than they are now. But clearly, obviously, there's not going to be enough that one can do. And if you actually look at the stock market, it's an experiment. And then because of this, intention at the outset, but then obviously then people start using the money for speculation, for gambling, and that obviously is something that the lesson actually learned from by the government, which I think they will obviously have to remedy moving forward.
超时了，所以我妈这 round 我就交给我们先。
Thank you very much.